Welcome back to the rise and fall of Wyte music.
So I woke up this morning and I thought to myself, these pussy niggas don't want it, brother AR off the shelf. Call up all of my niggas and kick my hat to the left. Looked in the mirror and said I'll never turn my back
baby
on myself.
Jesus.
Well, that Glock like a bell. Well, my stripes like a rep. Any nigga talking foul, hit his ass with a tip. Smoke a nigga like Snoop, that lighter strike in your lip. Push my button on the coupe, raise the roof like Luke and his bitch. That chopper hot as some lava, bet I'm cool as your fridge. I hear you little niggas talking, I'm in a pool with your bitch. And she say nobody feels you. And you nobody until somebody kills you. Kills you. So all these niggas must wanna be famous. You won't get the picture until I paint it. Drop a nigga quick like a R&B singer. Make you leak for a week like a brand new banger. Gotta keep an eye on these niggas so rank em. If you got a problem, I suggest you get a hanger. Gon' hang it up, you don't wanna not with us. This shit I got for you gon' be bad for your health. And I swear to God, you don't want it. I swear to God, you don't want it. Real talk, you don't want it. Real talk, you don't want it.
Partee and Lil Wyte traveled the world doing shows, even touring Japan for 10 days. But things wasn't always so easy booking shows for Lil Wyte in the beginning. Partee would have to overcome a lot of obstacles to secure paid gigs. Partee eventually came up with a formula that would later prove to be successful. Traveling the world with Wyte Music road manager, music producer Marco Dane, Lil Wyte and Partee would occasionally bump heads due to professionalism at venues.
So, where? You just tuned in to the Rise and Fall of Wyte Music Park, episode 2. And, I just want to reiterate to a lot of internet trolls that, my nigga, we ain't on no beef shit. Nigga, Lil Wyte, my brother. Nigga, brothers have disagreements all the time. Nothing changed. The love. Ain't no love lost, my nigga. I'm still getting it. Still, nigga, I could do an episode of MTV Cribs if I wanted to. You know what I'm saying? So please don't get it twisted. Back to the subject at hand. We started touring shows, doing with Japan, actually, man. 10-city tours, man. Shout out to the crew out there in Japan, man. We turned up out there. Love, one of the best times me and him ever had in our lives. Industry, rather. But for the most part, it wasn't always easy to get those shows. Actually, a lot of people don't know, we started the Wyte Music era, really. Let me make that understood, because originally with the 3-6 Mafia stuff going on, we did shows together then, but I was still in the group then. But after the 3-6 Mafia era, pretty much the Wyte Music stage, things was kind of hard booking shows for Lil Wyte. Starting off, I never forget. Nigga, I used to have promoters, nigga, laughing at me, nigga, when I called them trying to book a Lil Wyte show. Nigga, hanging up on it. I ain't let that stop me. What it did, it motivated me to go even harder. I had a nice product. All I had to do was get it in the right hands in front of the right people. So what we did, man, we started piggybacking shows with a rock band, man. Monday wasn't all that great. Matter of fact, it was shitty, but that wasn't the purpose at that time. The purpose was to remain active. So what that did, when people started seeing us on the road in these different states and these different shows, it struck the interest of other show promoters and probably for the people that laughed and didn't take me serious the first time I called them to book the shows. But eventually, it worked out. You know, we pretty much did it, went to all 50 states.
Let's play a game called Would You Die for Fame? How long do you expect to fool the public with bullshit albums that's really mixtape effort songs? Partee, Strategy of the Crown, killing that shit. Download on worldwidemixtapes.com. You think it's over?
But check this out. We started having issues on the road. This is like our first really time we ever had real arguments, me and my brother Lil Wyte. I'm about to check, man. You guys should know that. I'm the businessman. I got to make sure things clear at the end of the day. You know what I'm saying? We got bills to pay, mouths to feed. It started with the rock band because they was getting to the point where they thought all they had to do was throw a little party favors here. And party favors and fun. Actually, we had a lot of fun doing those shows with the rock bands. You know what I'm saying? Actually, probably some of the most fun we had. But at the end of the day, fun don't pay bills. Party favors don't pay bills. So we had to get to the money. And eventually, the rock band became real disrespectful. Even to the point where they thought, if we showed up late to a show, they could deduct money from our pay as if they was our bosses or something. Long story short, we left that situation, man. It got too disrespectful, and White realized what the business was, and we both agreed to just pretty much leave that situation. And when we did, by that time, we had our buzz back.
I wish, for a picture much bigger than this. I wish to have wine from my water, turn some bread into some fish. Yeah, I wish. All these bitches, all these hunters, all these racks on me, on me, on me. All these bitches, all these hunters, all these racks on me.
Yeah, check this out. Call it my folks JPG Media for any of your graphic design needs. You know what I'm saying? Tell them Partee sent you. Start going all over, giving them deals, and to the point where we was only in town, maybe. We was only in town maybe 2 to 3 days a week. And then when we went out of town doing shows, we was at home knocking features out. I came up with a bulletproof formula to where it pretty much guaranteed success. Shout out to my boy Marco Dane. Anybody that's around the town seen that we was cutting up. We was clearing house. Well, me and White Star kind of bumping heads on the road was because if we got an after party, the promoter 90% of the time don't want to pay us if they think that we're going to just kick it and stick around for the booze and party favors. Me and White kind of had our first few arguments about that. Mainly, him just wanting to kick it. He loved to touch his fans. He loved to be around his people, which I didn't have a problem with. But at the end of the day, nobody's going to pay us if we just going to hang out and kick it anyway.
Now is time for the Q&A segment with Partee.
What's up, man? I'm back in this chat. For the question and answers real quick. First question, come from my boy Justin Sears. He want to know, do I still own my royalties and everything from White Music? And my answer is, you better motherfucking know it. Anything you see with White Music on it, I get a cut off for. Any project you see with White Music on it, and executive produced by me, I get a cut off for. A little short time did go by where, I guess they call themselves trying to blackball me, whatever the case may be, where they weren't sending my checks. But I went and got one of the best entertainment lawyers in the game. And get to the bottom of it, and now everything is rolling on time and accordingly. I still get to cut off everything. I wouldn't have no other way. And his second question was, he seen that Sharon Rock left, and Frazier, White, and Miscellaneous and Thug Therapy, I guess, stayed. Was there any beef? To answer that question, I got the most respect for Sharon Rock because Sharon Rock the only one that didn't go for the feces bullshit. He seen what they was trying to do far as manipulate the public to think that it was still White Music, and he fell back. As far as Frazier goes, he never was signed to White Music as an artist. He was just pretty much an affiliate. Miscellaneous, I mean, I understand him. That's my homeboy. We still talk pretty much on a day-to-day basis. So he had another agenda in mind. And far as Thug Therapy goes, I mean, that's like White childhood homeboy. That's his friend. So they did right by rolling with him. That's his crew. But, man, as far as I know, as far as I'm concerned, there's no beef with anybody. Everybody's still cool. So if you got any questions you want to ask me, hashtag the Rise and Fall of White Music. Tag me, comment on whatever post you see, and I'm going to get to you, fam. And just like that, it's over with. Peace.
Nah, man, he ain't returning on my calls, my texts, man. What's up? What's good? Where? Nah, man, me and John ain't never had no conversation, no fallout about no money. I don't know what that's about, man, but that's what's up, though, man. Let me get back with you, fam.
Yeah. Yeah, to find out what that conversation was about, make sure you tune in next week to the Rise and Fall of White Music. We're going to have the money conversation because everybody's been talking about this and talking about that, but we're going to have the real conversation about the actual money and what was the talk about that. So, hey, stay on deck. Let's get it, bitch. Also, enjoy this bonus footage from last week's episode.
Jeffrey Dahmer, I'm out. Looking motherfucker made White think that the grass was greener on the other side. Only way he can get to the other side was crossing out the smart dude, which was Partee. That's not from me. That's from Lil Wyte. That's his favorite saying, that he was the name and I was the brain. But see, they wanted the name without the brain, thinking that they could still do what I done. They start scrapping together these mediocre producers sending these free beats online. I don't knock nobody sending their beats to artists online, but obviously you know that those producers don't get paid or it's not within the budget. So that's what they did. When you say scrap together beats, that's exactly what was done.